morning, everyone. Let's all stand together, please.
Chapters are not really about the whale. They're really about our God. He cares. He's concerned. He's going to answer you. He hears you. One of the best things that can happen to us is when we get swallowed by a fish called grace. When we get swallowed by God's divine mechanism, at the time it doesn't feel good. But looking back, we'll realize that this happened because God wanted to offer me another opportunity. Can I just tell you that running from God is going to cost you so much more than you want to pay?
Hello, I'm Laura Kasimov. That was just a short piece of the video that we're going to be starting our book series on Jonah tomorrow, 7 o'clock at Marilyn Plug's house. After that, it'll be at Ellen Hardiman's. Once a month, the first Monday of every month. I'll be outside with the books. If anybody hasn't purchased it, wants to attend, and they're $13. Secondly, I wanted to bring up Women's Retreat. We were all up at Pine Summit last week and had a wonderful time. We are taking signups today for next year's retreat, which will be September 27th through 29th. We're actually only going to have one retreat this next year, not two like we've had in the past. So I've been able to block off a group of rooms for us, and we need $25 deposit to hold your spots. And if you can have that paid by November 1st, sign up. Everything will be great. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. Once a year, Whittier Christian has a fundraiser for financial aid. On October 16th, it'll be our fourth annual Secure the Future annual fund breakfast. It's a fundraiser so that we can offer financial aid to our families. We offer it in faith. We've given about 80 families $140,000 in financial aid. Once they proved that they had a need, they anywhere from $500 a year to maybe $3,500 a year. But we give this off the bottom line, and that we just trust God that families, church members, will dig deep and respond to our Secure the Future. Last year, we raised $35,000. So in 3 years of breakfast, that means we've raised $100,000, and that's a tremendous testimony. But it's a tremendous commitment on the part of this church and the families and friends that love Whittier Christian. So Doris and Paula have invitations to the breakfast. If you can't come to the breakfast, you'd like to make a pledge. In another week or two, we'll have pledge cards. But we're trying to secure the future of a Christian education for Whittier Christian Schools, for the children that are here now, for their children, and for their children's children. We've had 66 years worth of Christian school education, and we'd like to secure the future for 66 years more. So if you could be a part of this, actually attending the breakfast, making a pledge, making a donation, Paula and Doris and I'd love to talk to you and help you continue securing the future at Whittier Christian Schools. Thank you.
Morning, Calvary. We've got some more announcements here. The men's retreat. If you want to go, see Pastor Israel. If you are signed, if you are signed up, you need to fill out the release form before you can go. You can do that right outside and just give it directly to Israel. Then in your bulletins, you've got a flyer for Ruby's Diner. It's a fundraiser. It's one for you and then one for your friend. So if you eat at Ruby's, and 20% of it's going to go to Whittier Christian. So tear it in half. Do some fundraising for Whittier Christian. Then winter camp for the youth group. Youth ministry camp packets are outside to get them. If you've got kids in high school or junior high, you don't want to miss this. It's going to be really rad. It's going to be a lot of fun and a lot of encouraging for the faith. And we've got the hike at Mount Baldy. And if you want to get some exercise, then go ahead and pick up a flyer at the information booth outside and hike Mount Baldy. And the details of the hike are going to be outside on the map. Thank you.
In the scriptures, it says this in Deuteronomy 6, 4 through 9. Will you guys stand with me for a moment as I read this? They speak to the people of God, and we are the people of God. And I know we're not Israel. But hear, O people of God, it says this in verse 4. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God. The Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on your door frames of your houses and on your gates.
Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear. Even though I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back, I know you are near. And I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. Let go, Lord, you never troubles, but until that day comes, we'll live to know you're here on the earth, and I will fear no evil, for my God is with me, and if my God is with me,
sing this song, At the Cross. It might be new to some of you, but let's give this one a try, At the Cross.
I bow my knee where your blood was shed.
Let's all come back together. We're going to sing this song, All Who Are Thirsty.
Pastor John has been reminding us that we can come before the throne of God with confidence because of what Jesus Christ has done. So join me as we approach the throne of grace. Gracious Father, it's in the name of Jesus, Father, for what he's done. Because of his faithfulness, his obedience, his righteousness, Father, that we can come before your throne of grace and mercy. Father, with humble hearts. And Father, we are reminded that we live in a fallen world, Lord, as our family, as our brothers and sisters go through so many trials and in their lives, Father, and so many of us are experiencing or know somebody that is experiencing illnesses, that are struggling with diseases. Father, we want to lift up our sister Frances. And her diagnosis, Father, it's not pleasant, Father. But we ask your mercy upon her, Father. We know you can hear in an instant. There's no doubt in us, Lord, that you can do this. And Father, we ask for that. Father, we ask that this journey that she'll be embarking on, Father, that she will feel your presence, Lord. I pray for Dale that, too, it'll be hard for him, too, to feel that peace in your presence in this situation, Lord. Father, we pray for Alicia Sur's friend Robert, as he also faces cancer. And Father, Robert has heard the word. We don't know if he has surrendered to you, Father, but we ask that you would reveal yourself to him, Father, and if we will call upon your name, Father, during this difficult time, Lord. Father, we know, like I said, so many that are afflicted with ailments. Ask your mercy upon them, Father, that we know we serve a God that cares, that they may feel that care, Lord. Father, we also pray for the marriages in this congregation, Lord, and those, Father, that you would strengthen them, Lord. Father, that we know there's struggles. It's not easy. But, Father, we ask that they would know that they would submit to one another out of reverence for you, and that you would be in the center of this, the marriages, and the kids that are part of this marriage, Father, that they would also experience that peace of knowing you, Lord, and that you care. Father, we pray for those that are struggling financially, Lord, because of either a lack of job or not enough income or things that have brought them to a very difficult situation, Father, and ask your mercy upon them, Father, that those that will be needing jobs, Father, that you will open doors for them, Lord. Guide them, direct them, Father, to find those jobs, Lord. And Father, we would also want to give you the praise, the glory, Father, for new life, for the new plug in the family, Lord. And we thank you for what you do in their life, and you continue to do so, and the joy that is experienced of a newborn, Lord. And Father, we give you thanks and we praise as we continue to praise you and worship you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. My name is Marilyn Plug, and I'll be teaching the children this morning. We're going to be reminded of God's love for us in sending people along our way to care for us. And today we're going to look at Jairus and what he did in his care for his daughter and how God blessed them. So invite all the children, kindergarten through sixth grade, to join me. Thank you.
I was thinking as we were singing that song, actually a number of songs that we did this morning, they come with often with emotional memories, don't they? Various emotional memories. And that last song, Teach Me Your Way, O Lord, is Dan often has us sing that song before the message. I think of singing that with my wife, Marilyn, before as we'd be sitting on the piano bench, as she would play the piano and we'd sing that together many, many, many times from high school and college and on. So, along the way, it's nice to, I hope you pick up the family prayer journal, and there's a lot of information in there. Some information that didn't make the prayer journal, we were asked to pray for, encouraged to pray for Frances Campbell. It says that she was experiencing back pain. Well, she got the word on Friday after a diagnosis that she has multiple myeloma in the spine. And this is going to be a long journey. And we want to continue to pray for Frances and her husband, Dale. And I know that you will pray. I know you will. Also in the family prayer journal, there is a word of praise in there, and that is that Susie Moeller, who's the director of our preschool and has worked in many capacities in throughout our ministry, this past week defended her thesis for her doctorate, and she passed. I have to tell you this. This is really cute. Can I say this, Susie? She was about to leave to go take this and know that she'd been sweating bullets for this. And she has worked so hard for so long. And she came in the office and she was talking to Dennis and to me. And she's going out. She's all dressed up. And she said, well, at least I know my shoes look good. So I think it was the shoes, Susie. Anyway, it must have been it. So congratulations. She has another presentation of that in April. And then she officially graduates in May. All right. And then we have to bow down to her and kiss her ring and things like that. So, real happy for you. Would you, I want you to do me a favor. Would you please take out your bulletin like this, okay? Then inside the bulletin, you'll see this beautiful color note page, all right? I want you to have both of these in your hands right now, all right? And as you take those out, just to kind of talk through the first couple paragraphs in the notes that you see there, starts out with a question, actually starts out with a scripture verse. And what I'd like to do right now is have us all read those words together. Inside of the notes, you'll see at the top are the words for our theme for the next about another 8 weeks or so. Let's read those words together from Hebrews 10:24. And let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works. Would you read it with me again? And let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works. Okay, now look at me and repeat those words. And let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works. Wow. Great. I want you to make sure we've got that memorized. I just spoke to the kindergarten through sixth grade here on this campus this week, and we said that a number of times. So at any moment, I might stop and have you repeat that with me, okay? Memorize it. Let it be pressed down into your mind and heart. So who's been on your mind and in your prayers lately? Just, I want you to think about that. Who's been on your mind and in your prayers? Over this last week, I was really blessed to hear from people as part of this ministry that they were praying for one another. As a matter of fact, I was with some folks who were dealing with their own very serious struggle this week. Very serious. And life was not very comfortable at that moment. And in the midst of that moment, and I've seen this so many times, they were overwhelmed, overtaken by a deep concern for other people from our congregation who were hurting at that moment. That's what happens. That's what happens when, as Jaime said, we've been in the presence of the Most High God. When we've been in His presence, and we've been listening to Him and worshiping Him and adoring Him and loving Him, our hearts go out to others. Today and for the next few weeks, and by the way, since we have all been recipients of people who've been considering how they could stir us up, stir up me and you up toward love and good works, because we've been through that before, I'm going to ask you to do something. You'll see this paragraph in your notes, the second full paragraph. It says, today and for the next few weeks, I'd like you to give me some feedback that I can use anonymously, okay? You can put your names on it, but I want to be able to use this anonymously, if you permit me to, in a way that will encourage others to cultivate an others mindset. You understand what that is? Last week we talked about this, about cultivating a mindset that is others-oriented. That's what this verse is all about. Consider, think about this, ponder this. Let this be part of your life. How can I stimulate someone else toward love and good deeds? And what I'd like to do is, every week for the next few weeks, and right now I'd like you to take out your Keeping in Touch form. Would you make sure that's why I wanted you to have the bulletin in your hands. Would you make sure you tear off the right-hand side and then fill that out, but on the back side, and next week, you'll actually have a feature on the back side next week. But right in these few lines on this side, if you want to do this today, it'd be wonderful to get some feedback from you. I'd like to ask you for your response for these two questions. Who has inspired you recently, or who has stirred you, or who has spurred you on to do something that you know God wants you to do? That is, who spurred you on toward love and good works, love and good deeds? So I want you to just give me a little bit of information. Who has spurred you on? I've got to say, this week, numerous people did that. From a 5-year-old to an 85-year-old. And I'm telling you, seriously, people spurring me on to love and good deeds. I was spurred on, inspired, and just ready to go forward once again by things that men from our ministry, put it this way, men from our school did this past week to spur, they did to something to some for someone else. And man, that just really, it's like, it raises the question inside of my heart, what am I doing in that regard? So I'd like your feedback. Who has inspired you recently to do something that God wants you to do? And then the second question is, how did they do that? So don't just give me the name, but tell me how they did, how they inspired you to move forward in love and good deeds. Would you do that? Would you think about that? This is over the next 8 weeks. If you're not ready, you don't have to do that today, but if you're ready today, please don't hold back and let me know. Just 2 or 3 lines. It would be just great. Let's say the verse again. Let us consider how we may spur one another on to love and good works. Let us consider, let's think about it, how we can spur one another on. This morning, and for the next few weeks, how can you spur someone else on to love? This morning, we're going to focus on this issue of love. And by the way, I'm sorry to say that in your notes, nah, I'm not sorry to say, this is the way it goes. In your notes, ask the question, how can we stir one another on to love God? That's the only one part of this of these notes today, but you can use both sides to just, you can take notes all along the way. How can I, ask yourself this question, how can I stir someone else on to love God? You think that's important to him, that we encourage, stimulate someone else to love him? Is that your business? Is that my business? Do you think? I know this sounds like maybe it's a rhetorical question, but in the depths of our soul, we've got to answer that question. Is that really something that I'm supposed to do? Like how often, and how am I going to do that? I mean, some people might say, I was never trained in Bible college. I mean, that's not for me. That's not God's will for me, really. I didn't go to seminary to learn that. I mean, I haven't been a Christian for all these years. I'm supposed to encourage someone else? Maybe you might say, did you know that God would have you encourage me and spur me on to love and good deeds? It's not just my job because I'm paid to be good. It's your job as well to stir my heart on to love and good deeds. And how are you going to do that anyway? I'm no preacher, Pastor. And I don't like to preach anyway to people. Well, how are you going to do it? I mean, what kind of an impact can you have on somebody? To change the course of, you know, to change their direction. I mean, you can't move me. I'm a hard-headed old man. Right? Amen? Amen? Amen. Oh, sorry. You know, anybody over 60 is, their mind is made up, right? About everything. I was at the Minnesota State Fair. I shared this with some of the children, so I want to share this with you. I was at the Minnesota State Fair. Haven't been there probably in 30, 35 years, but Marilyn and I were back at the end of August, and so we went and we had to eat fair food. Oh, it was great. Walked right in the gate and went right for a corn dog. Everything in Minnesota is on a stick. Everything is. If you imagine that you could eat it, I even saw that. Now this is really funny. Everything is on a stick. They even had beer on a stick. You're wondering how do they get beer on a stick? Well, they had to kind of be very creative to do this. They had a little kind of a paddle board with three holes in it, and they put three little cups in it. So everything's on a stick. There are, if you watch television, it says savings on a stick. You know, so you get insurance savings on a stick. I don't know. But anyway, there are more profound things to see at the Minnesota State Fair besides beer on a stick. So when I got to the fair, I went with my nieces, and they're in their mid-20s. And they've been going for years, and they do all the same stuff, but with all the same enthusiasm that they had when they were little girls. And but the big item at the fair, beyond the hot dogs on a stick and turkey on a stick, the big deal is going to the animal barns. Oh, man, that's fun. And, you know, you go into these, you know, we don't have animals in our home, you know, but you go in these barns and, you know, you get the smell of things you don't normally smell. And so we started out in the poultry barn, which not only included birds, but also had it also had bunnies, and they're amazing. The flop-eared rabbits, they're just wonderful. And then we see the things being shown and judged, and then we went on to the sheep barn, and we saw kids walking around that just loved their sheep and goats. And I'll never forget, this was just one of those kind of like heart-rending. These kids are there, they're petting their goats, you know. And it says there that this kind of a goat is a meat goat. And I'm going, you know what that means. This kid is loving this animal that ain't going to be around too long. And it's not. I said, so how long do you have these animals? And this one teenage girl said, well, it was born in February. August, okay. And so how long do you have them? Well, it goes to market in October or November. Some love for their animals, right? Well, we left there and went to the pig barn and watched a young girl try to get the pig out of a stall and then move it down the aisle. And that was wild. And then we went into the horse barn. This is like the culmination of this for my niece, Jordan. Jordan, who's twice she's been part of a team to swim the English Channel. Very competitive girl, attacked life from the moment that she was born. But when we got in that horse barn, all of a sudden, boom, she just split. And Kurt said, you just watch this. Her dad, phew, she was to the back of the barn. And eventually, we got back as far as she was. And it was in this one long aisle. And it was full of the Percherons. You know what Percherons are? They're big workhorses. You know, they're like the Clydesdales. Big, beautiful, jet black horses. And they're just stunning. And they are so huge. I'm 6 feet tall. And the backs of these horses, they're about 73 inches. They're about as high as, they're about my height at their backs. And then the necks, massive necks go up from there and heads. These big black eyes looking down at you. They're just amazing animals. They're huge. They're wide. They're 2,000 pounds. 2,000 pounds of muscle. Hoofs like this big. They're just gigantic. And you see these, you know, after watching this young girl trying to move this 300-pound pig around, I'm seeing these young kids in the stalls gently petting these horses, stroking their necks. And then they moved them out into the aisle to move them on for show. You know how they did it? They didn't do it with spurs even. They didn't move them on with spurs. They were like a version of a horse whisperer, just gently speaking to their horses and just hand on the neck, and just gently on a rope, just moving them out into the aisle, right past me. I'm about ready to get pinned up against the wall with these massive horses. I say all of this because the Bible tells us that we are to think about how we can spur one another on, move one another on. Sometimes people with their heads made up, sometimes people with their hearts heavy with the things that have just overwhelmed their life. But we are called to spur one another on to love God. That's a tall order. So who's come alongside of you in your life? Maybe they just kind of put their hand on your shoulder to speak gently into your ear to encourage you to love the one whom you've never seen but that you've heard about. Who was it that spoke his name gently into your ear and to your soul, to your conscience, and prompted you to love him? Turn with me, please, in your Bibles to the fifth book of the Bible, to Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy chapter 6. Pastor Israel read these words to us this morning at the beginning of our worship time. Deuteronomy chapter 6. He read these words that are referred to as the Shema. The Shema. In Israel and among God's people, these words, this is the Shema. In our language, the word would be spelled S-C-H-E-M-A, Shema. The word Shema means hear. That's what it means. It means listen. Listen to this. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God. Verse 4, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God. Hear him. The Lord our God, the Lord is one. You're moving into a land, Israel, where there are many, many gods. They're all counterfeit. They are all counterfeit. Hear, listen, Israel. The Lord our God is one. He is the only one. That's what it means. He's the only one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. These commandments I give you today are to be upon your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road and when you lie down and when you get up. Surround yourself with these words, these commandments. Tie them as symbols on your hands. Bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. Surround yourself with these commands. With what commands? How would Jesus have summarized these commands? Do you know how he would have summarized them? We actually know how he would summarize them. You know how he summarized them? In the Gospels, someone came to Jesus and said, I kind of wanted to trick him. So what's the greatest commandment? What did he say? Love God with every ounce of your being. Love him with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Love him. And it will show. Here's the second command. Love your neighbor as yourself. In other words, you could take this whole law and summarize the whole law with love the Lord your God. You won't have any other gods if you love him with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Love him with every ounce of your being. And when you do so, then follow through with loving your neighbor as yourself. This I know for sure. I'm to love God with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength. And I know this for sure. What else do I know for sure from verse 6? I'm to impress these commands. I'm to impress this on my children and on my grandchildren. And I'm to impress this on everybody I know. I'm to give them a taste of what it is like to love God with every ounce of my being. That's what I know for sure. Have you ever wondered what your calling was in life? Some people say, I wonder what my calling is. My calling? I haven't heard any voices. Am I supposed to hear voices? Yeah, listen to mine, will you? This is what God says is our calling. If you're a mom or dad, a brother or sister, if you're a friend, impress upon the hearts of the people around you, love God with every ounce of your being. I know what it's like to raise kids. And I know what it's like to raise kids and be concerned for their well-being from the moment we brought them home from the hospital. Struggling with them sometimes through exceedingly serious illness, perilous illness. And then through the standard things like fevers and I know what it's like to be concerned for them, for their grades or their reputation or their friendships. I know what it's like to be concerned for them as they leave the house and try to make it on their own. I know what it's like. And to want the best for them. I know what it's like to hope that they'll find someone that they can entrust their lives to in a marriage. They know what it's like to be concerned about their employment or unemployment. I know all that. I know what it's like to be concerned about the length of their lives. But my greatest concern for them, bar none, all of that stuff, all of it is peanuts. It's secondary by a long shot compared to that they would love God with all their hearts, soul, mind, and strength. Everything else is X's and O's. It's just, that's the most important thing. And along the way, as you raise your kids, you look for little signs here and there that maybe, just maybe they do. I know what it's like we've got a long driveway. Just indulge me for a moment. We got a long driveway at our home. My neighbors used to say, when our kids were in college, it was just like it was a comedy to watch us. It's always like the last car in the driveway, with all the kids having cars and driving and off to school and jobs. It was like a joke to watch. It was a one car out after another just to get the back car out. And I know what it's like to move one of my kids' cars. And sometimes the music in there would be, whoa! What was that? And I'm not talking that it was just a little upbeat. I'm just like, whoa. Okay. And then I know what it's like to get in that car, that same car, and hear music that lifts up the name of God. Just for a moment in time to say, oh, thank you, Lord. And then you come to another moment when you, and some of you parents have been so blessed to see this or hear this. When you take care of your kids' kids, and your kids are not around, now you find out what goes on at home. Now, by the way they behave, by the things they say, by the values they carry. And what an absolute amazing thing if you get just a little glimpse and you hear a grandchild speaks the name of Jesus with very real affection. Not to impress you, but simply because they've come to know He is. You see, we have a job to do, parents. And friends, and relatives, we have a job to do. We have a calling, and that is to love God with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and then to pass that on to our children, and our friends, and our co-workers, and our neighbors. To love God so much that His name is spoken with real affection. To love God so much that people around us just catch the fact that we're trusting God and not some phony God. Even good gods like a good job and good gods like a like good health and, you know, all those good gods that we seem to think are the end all far too easily. But when people know that we, bottom line, speak his name with real affection because we've been with him in the most holy place, and we love him. I sat with our missionary, Tom Ward, who's a missionary in Pakistan and in East London. And Tom was here for our missions conference about a year and a half ago, and as Tom and I would pray together, he prayed in a way that I heard him pray with my dad before he died. And he would always pray in the midst of his prayer, always, "We love you, Lord." And I knew when Tom prayed, "We love you, Lord," man, he meant it. And let me tell you, when I hear a grandchild, unprompted by a parent or by a grandparent, say, "We love you, Lord," God is using that child to say to this old guy, "How much do you love him? How much do you love God?" You see, friends, we have a calling, and that calling is to encourage one another to love God with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. The Apostle John, you think he was convinced of that we were to love God? Oh, yeah. You think he was convinced that there was a love relationship between the Father and the Son? Between the Father God and his Son Jesus? John was absolutely convinced of that. Would you turn with me, please, in your Bibles to the back of the Bible, to 1 John chapter 1. 1 John chapter 1. If you're using the Bible in the rack in front of you, it's page 1207. Listen to how John describes Jesus and about why he's writing this letter to these people. By the way, John by this time is probably in his 90s when he's writing this. Grandpa John, I like the ring of that, Papa John, he's writing to these people, and this is what he says, "That which was from the beginning," he's talking about Jesus, "he was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked at, and our hands have touched, this we proclaim concerning the word of life. This life appeared, we have seen it, we testify to it, and we proclaim to you the eternal life which was with the Father and has appeared to us. We proclaim to you that which we have seen and heard. We tell you about this Jesus and about this love relationship that he had with the Father, so that you also may be in fellowship with us, and our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We write this to make our joy complete." We want you to know. We're going to talk about Jesus over and over and over again, layer upon layer, about how much he loves us. Because he wants us to love him back. John captured these words in his gospel when he talks about how Jesus said, "This is how you will show that you love me. If you do what I say. If you do what I say." I'm not talking about just an emotional feeling. I'm not talking about just simply speaking my name with clarity. I'm talking about following through and doing what I say. Just as I've loved my Father, and I do whatever he says. This so captured John that by the end of his gospel letter, the end of his gospel, in chapter 21, he takes us to a scene by the lake when Jesus says to Peter, the apostle Peter, who's dropped the ball one time after another and who denied Jesus three times. Three times he denied even knowing him. Love him, are you serious? He said, I don't know the man. Get off my case. Because he was scared for his, too scared for his own life. And at the end, sitting by the lake, the resurrected Jesus turned to Peter. I don't know what Jesus was doing at the time. I don't know if he was writing in the sand. I don't know if he was still eating a little bit of the fish that he prepared for the disciples. But he turned to Peter and he said, Peter, do you love me? Do you love me with an absolute, well-thought-out commitment to love me? Have you thought through what this means to love me, Peter? Do you love me? And Peter said, Lord, you know I love you like a brother. I love you, bro. He changed the word love. I love you, bro. You know, guys don't like to, they say I love you. You know, they wrap their arms around you and pat you three times on the back anymore, you know. Kind of spooky. So basically, Peter just chose to use a different word. I love you, bro. Jesus continued to sit there, and he said to Peter a second time, Peter, do you love me? Have you thought this through? Do you love me? Do you love me with an agape love, the same kind of love that took me in obedience to the Father to the cross? Do you love me? And will you follow me to the ends of the earth is essentially what he was asking. Do you love me like that? And he said, love you, bro. You know everything. You know I love you. Love you like a brother. And the third time Jesus said, okay, Peter, do you love me like a brother? And I know Peter was brokenhearted at that time. Because Jesus changed his tune for him. And he said, oh Lord, you know everything. You know I love you like a brother. And three times Jesus gave him an unbelievable assignment. For a guy that had denied him three times, he said, I want you to take care of my kids. I want you to feed my sheep. Take care of my kids. So, our calling is to love God with every ounce of our being, every ounce of our being. I don't know, but if God were to, I mean, he knows where every one of us is at today. He knows how we've been loving him, whether that love has been an exclusive love this week or whether our love has been kind of trashed on this thing or that thing or some other thing. We put our hope and our dreams in something else this week. Maybe not ultimately, but kind of, that was pretty important to us. He knows where our hearts are, and he would say to us, do you love me? Have you been with me in my presence in the most holy place? Has the gaze of your soul been on me? Okay, if it has. And think about how you can encourage someone else to love me. Take them along on the journey. Put your hand on their shoulders. Walk them down that aisle like that young man did with that big Percheron. Walk them down the aisle and just talk to them about the reality of in just as you talk about life, talk about the reality of loving God and where that's taking you and where it could take them. Show them by the words you say, by the way you obey Jesus, by the things you invest your life in. Show them. Let us us consider how we may spur one another on to love God. Father, thanks so much for, I thank you personally so much for your amazing love. Thanks for the love that Jesus demonstrated to his disciples. He lived up to his calling just completely by showing them what it was, where love would take him and where it would take them. And I pray, Father, that you would stir my heart to love you more. And I pray that would be the prayer of each one here today, that you would take us where we're at right now and stir us to love you more. And then as we love you, may the people around us, our children, our parents, our siblings, our friends, our neighbors, co-workers, may they taste what it's like to love you. So that today or someday, they would be able to say, like my friend Tom, we love you, Lord. And know where that love will take them. Father, I pray that love for you would make just all the difference in the world for us. And that we would live up to our calling. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you make sure that you are prepared in a moment? Reuben's going to come. And would you make sure that you're prepared to hand in those keeping in touch forms? Thanks.
As we take our tithes and offerings, pray with me, would you please? Father, we thank you for all of your provisions in our lives, and we acknowledge that as we give back to you, it's because of the blessings that you have given us. Pray that our tithes and offerings would be a testimony for our love to you, that we love you because you first loved us. Pray that the money that we give back to you, that it is used to feed your sheep here locally in Whittier and to the ends of the earth with missionaries and other projects that minister to people. We love you. And we thank you for the blessings that you give us. In Jesus' name, amen.
As we close, I want to remind you who were gone last week that we have cups outside that we would like you to have, especially you ladies who weren't here and didn't get one. If you would like to give us $5 toward those coffee or tea cups or whatever you put in there, cocoa, milk, Gatorade, I don't know. Water, it's kind of weird to drink water out of a coffee cup, but go ahead, feel free. We'll be right outside. We want you to have one. And if you don't have any money, please take one. You could pay us later. If you want to get another one, buy it. Great. Drink water in it. Please take one. Let me pray for you. Thank you, Father, for these people and their love for you. And I pray that we would grow in depths of knowing what it means to spur one another on to love and good deeds. In Jesus' name, amen.